video is sponsored by Truefire. Over 2 million guitar players worldwide improve their playing using Truefire's online lesson systems. Learn, practice, and play with Truefire. Hi, this is Keith Williams. Welcome to 5 Watt World, where I'm interested in helping you get the most music from the least gear. As I was researching Rickenbacker history for this video, my new copy of Guitarist Magazine arrived in the mail. As is often the case, they seem to have a copy of my to-do list. Right in the middle of the issue was an article by one of my favorite guitar writers, Neville Martin. And he managed to sum up the jumble of thoughts in my head about Rickenbacker in 2 sentences. As I said, he's one of my favorite writers. It's almost impossible to imagine how music from the latter part of the 20th century on would have sounded without Rickenbacker guitars and basses. Pack-leading artists such as The Beatles, The Who, The Byrds, Steppenwolf, Tom Petty, R.E.M., The Jam, Motorhead, The Eagles, Yes, Genesis, Rush, The Smiths, U2, have all used Rickenbacker instruments to help them stand out from the crowd. Great quote. Those are some bands, and all using a guitar that I think of most of us would initially dismiss as doing one thing, and only one thing well, the jangle. That unique character of mid-range that typifies what we all hear in our heads when we think of a Rickenbacker guitar. And before it grates on your nerves through the entire video, one way or another, let's get this out of the way. It's Rickenbacker, not Rickenbacker. I'll cover why that's the case in the video. So if you'd like to know the story of this premier U.S. company and the worldwide impact of their electric 12-string guitars, a company that has resisted all temptation to move production overseas and has stayed true to their limited level of manufacturing right there in California, then stay tuned, because this is the 5-Watt World short history of the Rickenbacker 12-string electric. If you enjoy our videos, take a minute to subscribe and hit the bell icon to be notified when we put out new videos. And if you've already subscribed, swing by the store to grab a t-shirt or a hoodie. It goes a long way to keeping the channel going. To see what we're doing every day, follow us at 5-Watt World on Instagram. And if you don't need another hoodie but want to support 5-Watt World, think about becoming a friend of 5-Watt. The links are in the description. And in response to requests, I've also added a tip jar. Rudolf Rickenbacker was born in Basel, Switzerland in 1887, but his family soon moved to the States and settled in Los Angeles in 1918. It was there, at the age of 31, that he established a successful tool and die firm, stamping out metal and plastic parts. By the late 20s, making parts for guitar companies had become a major income source for his business. National String Instruments Corporation was one of those customers and was very close to the shop in Los Angeles. This relationship grew, with Rickenbacker's company building metal bodies and resonators for the National guitars. It's debated which of the partners at National, either Dopiera or Beauchamp, invented the cone system that makes the resonator guitars what they are. Beauchamp eventually became general manager at National and was still looking for ways to make guitars even louder, and this would mean looking for a way to amplify the instrument. Beauchamp's experiments yielded a pickup with a pair of horseshoe-shaped magnets enclosing the pickup coil surrounding the strings. They built a working version on a slab of maple with the pickup as a proof concept for the pickup. This was the wood frying pan guitar. This was in 1931, and it is correctly thought of as the first of all electric guitars. They filed a patent application for the pickup in 1934, and it was granted in August of 37. To add to our eventual confusion, Rickenbacker originally used the non-anglicized spelling of Rickenbacker on the earliest brochures. Between the wars, a less German-sounding pronunciation was adopted to distance themselves from what was happening in Europe. By 34, they were adding the pickup to a hollow body guitars that they had bought from K or Harmony that were designed to be played Spanish style, or sitting up as is common now. In 1935, Electra produced its first Bakelite guitars, building both lap steel and a Spanish style guitar referred to as the Model B. These first Bakelite Spanish guitars were the genuine first solid body electric guitar. Well, actually, they were semi-hollow, as the cavities under the top helped reduce the weight. Beauchamp ran the electric guitar company, while Rickenbacker continued to run the tool and die business in the other half of the building. But in 1940, Beauchamp had become tired of the electric guitar business and sold his share in Electro and left. It's here that Doc Kaufman, their early innovator and collaborator with Leo Fender, overlaps with Electro history. He designed a vibrola, and Electro entered an exclusive license to use it on their Spanish electric guitars. It would be used on various models until 1960. In 1942, Electro stopped producing musical instruments and began producing items for the war effort. Once 1946 came around, they were starting to get back into the instrument business. But then Rudolf Rickenbacker had turned 60 years old and, like Beauchamp, seemed to have tired of the instrument business and decided to sell the company. Enter Francis Carey, F.C. Hall. An early adopter of radio, he'd built a radio repair business and by 1936 had morphed into a wholesale parts company for radio repair in Santa Clara, California. By 1945, they'd become the exclusive distributors of the new Fender Instrument Company, selling their electric lap steel and amps. It was through the growth of this association that F.C. Hall developed an interest in running his own musical instrument company. And so it was that in late 1953, Hall bought the Electro String Music Company from the Rickenbackers. As part of the deal, they could continue to use the Rickenbacker name with no further payments for use. The factory was still on Southwestern Avenue in Los Angeles and had just 6 employees, including Paul Barth, when Hall bought the company. Around 1954, Hall hired Roger Rossmeisel. Rossmeisel had been born in Germany, and his father was a jazz guitarist who'd started to build guitars in the 30s. Roger learned about building guitars from his father, and after the war, he decided to emigrate to the U.S. After an abortive year working for Ted McCarty at Gibson in Michigan, 1954 saw Rossmeisel hired at Electro to help develop new designs. That same year, Electro launched their first modern electric guitars with the Rickenbacker Combo 600 and Combo 800, listing at $229.50 and $279.50. While it's suggested that Rossmeisel was certainly influenced by the Les Paul guitars that were launched while he was at Gibson, it seems that the guitar designs were a joint effort of Rossmeisel, Hall, and Barth. These double cutaway guitars had a carved top, and at first each had a single horseshoe pickup, although the 800 was a multi-coil pickup that was an early humbucking design. The guitars had the underlined Rickenbacker logo that is still on the guitars today. According to the Hall family, the logo had been designed by FC's wife, Lydia, including the distinctive pointed plate under the logo. By 1956, Electro was moving away from the horseshoe pickup in favor of a new design. That year, they relaunched the Combo 400 with the new pickup and a new body shape for $174.50. The new shape is now referred to as the tulip shape due to the outward curves of the cutaways. The neck through design also began that year and would become a big part of Rickenbacker's legacy. As the name implies, a neck through has a neck that extends the entire length of the instrument and has wings attached to it to form the body. By 1957, they had released 3 new short-scale model guitars, the 900, 950, and 1000. Initially launched with a tulip body, they moved to a new shape with an inward-curving lower cutaway. But the body style that would seem recognizable to us, that shape was launched in 1957 with the launch of the Combo 650 and 850. On these small-body guitars, we see new sweeping crescent-shaped curves across the two cutaways. These new models also had Rickenbacker's double truss rod design. Repairmen found this confusing, but it wasn't until 1984 that Rickenbacker would simplify the design. 2 new solid body models with a new body shape. The new hooked upper arm of the 425 and 450, creating the now familiar cresting wave shape. This shape has been used many times since and is still used today. In retrospect, 58 was the year that set up Rickenbacker for its success in the 60s. The new thin hollow body designs, known as the Capri, named for Hall's family cat, were largely the brainchild of Roger Rossmeisel. They added a thick body model to the Capri series, featuring a deeply carved body. Rossmeisel's German heritage shows in the design, as it includes a raised shoulder along the edge of the body that's known as a German carve. Despite listing many versions of the thick body design in the price list, they actually only built one version, the 2-pickup 381, which listed for $498. In 1960, the Quarrymen, a 3-guitar group in Liverpool, England, got their start in the local clubs. After a few variations on their name, they settled on the Beatles. The addition of a bass player and a drummer meant that their manager was able to secure what would turn out to be a grueling run at the Kaiserkeller Club in Hamburg, Germany. Their instruments were inexpensive and poorly made, but they played the long gigs night after night on them. And while in Hamburg, Lennon bought his Rickenbacker 325. Harrison later said in an interview that Lennon bought it at the Steinway Music Store in Hamburg, and it was the first Rickenbacker either of them had ever seen in person. The instrument had been hanging on the wall for 2 years, as the serial number indicates that it had been built in 1958. The 325 had the Kaufman vibrato, a natural maple finish, and the standard cooker knobs. Lennon replaced the knobs with Hofner types, swapped out the Kaufman vibrato for a Bigsby, and in late 62 would have the guitar refinished in black. Back at the factory, in 1960, the 2-tone brown sunburst finish was renamed Autumn Glow, and the red to yellow burst became Fire Glow. They also replaced the old Kaufman vibrato with a new sprung steel plate model that they dubbed the Accent. By 61, they'd introduced the new deluxe models with the same body shape as the 425 and the 450, dubbed the 460. This is when we see the 5th blend knob added to the 4 regular controls layout. This was added to deal with the perceived problem in pickup balance. The neck and bridge pickups on Ricks have matched output values, so the neck pickup generally sounds louder than the bridge. When the selector is in the neck only or bridge only, the selector lets you blend in some of the unselected pickup. When the selector's in the middle position, it lets you blend the balance of the two pickups. Now you might think, sitting there, that with having two volumes and two tone knobs already, that would do this very well. But the blend puts the balancing act on a single knob, and when understood by the player, can be used to great effect. Decades later, George Harrison would find himself debating Tom Petty on what exactly the blend knob did. Harrison saying it did nothing, and Petty encouraging him to try to use it to get subtle blending of tones. Rickenbacker's 62 Priceless had no fewer than 32 electric models in four distinct groups. The combo solid body series, the 310 to 375 thin hollow bodies, the F series, full hollow bodies, and the thick body series with just the single 381 model. It was in 1963 that Hall and his staff decided to develop an electric 12-string. Flat-top acoustic 12-strings had been around in the U.S. since about 1900, but the folk boom of the 60s revived interest in the big sound of the 12-string, and so all the top brands, Gibson, Guild, and Martin, would release 12-string acoustics around this time. The inimitable and hugely influential Pete Seeger had had a 12-string built in 1959 by Stanley Francis out in Liverpool, and if he wasn't playing his banjo, he was playing that guitar, its booming voice driving concert halls full of people singing along to Wild Rover or If I Had a Hammer. The Rooftop Singers had a hit with their 12-string driven Walk Right In at the start of 1963, playing a pair of Gibson 12-strings. The tuning of having the four lowest courses be a standard pitch and an octave above, and the two top pairs being in unison, was common system in use by that time. There were earlier 12-string electrics, but none that would have the impact in the market of the coming Rick. In the wake of these hits, Hall had set his sights on building a 12-string at Rickenbacker. Dick Burke was the head of the company's woodshop, and he was tasked with making a 12-string within their existing designs. To make it work, Burke came up with the idea of a peghead that has a set of standard-oriented 6-string tuners, and then a set of tuners that extend into a shallow channel carved in the headstock, like channels on a classical guitar headstock, and only slightly tweak the overall design at the headstock in the process. They built three prototypes, two 360s and a 620. The most notable difference between the Rick 12-string design and others is that the low-string octave pairs the lower string on the top. So a downstroke strikes the lower pitch first, the opposite of most other modern 12-strings. The first prototype was placed with guitarist and singer Susie Arden, who had a regular gig at the Golden Nugget in Las Vegas. Hall gave her the guitar, and she later joked that she just wouldn't give it back, and it had to replace the electrified acoustic Martin 12 she'd been using in the act. London-based Rose Morris & Company Limited had reached out to Rickenbacker about distributing their guitars in the UK. In 63, Hall heard from them again, but also from the Jennings Musical Instrument Company, who was already distributing Fender, Selmer, and Gibson. Realizing the growing popularity of the Beatles in the US, Roy Morris included a clipping of the Beatles showing their Rickenbackers. In the following month, Morris and his colleague Wolf made the trip to Santa Ana, California, and signed a distribution deal. They ordered 450 pieces, and it was at this meeting that Wolf encouraged Hall to reach out to the Beatles' manager and offer some publicity in coordination with their upcoming appearances in the U.S. He gave him Brian Epstein's address in Liverpool. Hall phoned Epstein early in January of 64 and arranged a meeting for the following month when the Beatles would be in the States. As I mentioned, Hall was used to encouraging players to use Rickenbacker gear. He'd had an arrangement with Ricky Nelson and Jim Reeves, but he seemed to sense the magnitude that was the Beatles at that time. They set the meeting for February 8th, but when the day came, Harrison didn't feel well, and he stayed back at their hotel. Of course, Harrison was very familiar with Ricks from Lennon's 325, and in the summer of 63, he'd briefly used a Rick 425 during one of the residencies in Hamburg, but he'd grown tired of the Rick and moved on to the Gretsch. The three remaining Beatles came to the meeting. Hall had brought the second prototype 12. This was one deluxe model with 360 features. Lennon immediately asked if they could take the 12 across the park to show it to Harrison. Harrison remembered that he liked the guitar right away, that the layout was intuitive. Hall promised to provide a few more instruments. They would send John Lennon a black 325 and the new 5-control layout to replace his road-worn and refinished 325. He also promised to send Lennon a custom 12-string in the 325 style. The Beatles returned to London and went back into Abbey Road Studios to finish their next single, Can't Buy Me Love. He played the 12-string on the B-side, You Can't Do That. The sounds left guitarists scratching their heads about what instrument was making those sounds. Melody Maker magazine called the Electric 12 the Beat Boys' secret weapon. It could become the musical instrument of 1964. Burns and Vox had also made Electric 12s by this point, but they just weren't having the impact of the new Rick in Harrison's hands. The Beatles, meanwhile, were recording and filming A Hard Day's Night, and the 12-string was used often, including the famously ambiguous opening chord for the title tune. Though not the only instrument used on that chord, it certainly provides a harmonic complexity seldom heard prior. Back in the U.S. at the summer of 64, a show at the Hollywood Bowl would see F.C. Hall and his son in attendance in the audience to see Lennon and his 325 and Harrison come out onto the stage with the 12-string to launch into an opening song of Twist and Shout. But Harrison used his 12 often, including most notably, of course, on the intro to Ticket to Ride. During their third tour in the U.S. in 1965, Harrison would be given a new 360-12 style guitar. It was this guitar that was used on Rubber Soul, and that would be the last prominent appearance of Harrison's Rick 12 in the Beatles catalog. The impact of the Beatles tour, but in particular all the footage in A Hard Day's Night with the boys playing their Ricks, had a massive impact on the demand for the guitars. Rickenbacker added a large third building at the factory in Santa Ana to help cope with the surge in demand. Over in Britain, Rose Morris benefited as the UK distributor as well as it should be, since it was Wolfe who connected Rick with the Beatles in the first place. In 64, Rick added two electric models to their regular production line, the 360-12 with two pickups, double-bound body, slash-style sound hole, and triangle fingerboard markers first appeared in the 64 July price list at $550. They also added a 370-12, a three-pickup version that was not on the price list and was likely a special-order-only guitar. They also launched the 360-style guitars in 64, with the curved top edges which relegated the binding to the back only. The new design was supposed to be more comfortable for the player, and while Rickenbacker moved this style from main production, old-style sharp-edge bodies could still be ordered. In 63, they redesigned the tailpiece from a rather plain-looking trapeze piece of flat metal to the striking, stylized R. Dick Burke said that they copied the R from the fan hats for the Washington football team. In August of 65, two further 12-string models appeared on the price list. The 450-12, a solid-body 450 with two pickups for $294.50, and the 330-12, a non-deluxe version of the 360-12 with dot fingerboard markers and an unbound body for $444.50. In the wake of the Beatles, bands in America were looking to get the sound of the 12-string Rick as well, the most famous of which is undoubtedly Roger McGuinn of the band The Jet Set, who were about to change their name to The Byrds. McGuinn had previously used acoustic 12-strings, both a Stella and a Gibson. When A Hard Day's Night opened in theaters, McGuinn and others were able to get a look at Lennon's 325, but along with Harrison's use of the Gretsch, they saw the 12-string Rick. McGuinn added, "I knew right then the secret of their wonderful guitar sound. It was a Rickenbacker 12-string." The Byrds' manager convinced an investor to loan the band $5,000 for new instruments, and showing the level of Beatles influence, McGuinn bought both a 360-12 and a Gretsch 6-string. McGuinn's first Rick was the 360-12 Maple Glow, with the rounded front, and was built in October of 64. It had two pickups and the regular 5-control knob layout. This was the guitar used in the 1965 albums Mr. Tambourine Man and Turn, Turn, Turn. Running the 12-string with some studio compression, it made the sound the Byrds would be famous for. In February of 66, McGuinn convinced Rick to add a third pickup to his number one, making it look more like a Model 370. He also had the guitar rewired with volumes for each pickup, a master volume and two selectors, one for selecting pickups and the other one for tone options. Number one would be lost at a gig at a college in New York. He eventually replaced the guitar with another Maple Glow with the custom control layout, but by that point, Rickenbacker was supplying them for a 50% discount. He'd used the guitar until 1971 on all the recordings and concerts. To hear the ultimate sound of the Rick, I'd point you at The Bells of Rimini from the debut Mr. Tambourine Man, which features hard-panned, multi-tracked electric 12s into a symphony of harmonic complexity that is simply stunning. Meanwhile, back across the pond, a young Mr. Peter Townsend was enjoying a Rick 12 that he'd acquired from the good people at Rose Morris. He used the guitar on The Who's first big hit, I Can't Explain, in November of 64. Townsend called his 12-string Rick a chord machine. Brian Jones played a Vox 12-string, but also had a Rick 12, and is supposedly that guitar that he used on The Stones' Get Off My Cloud in 1965. The Rick 12 also began appearing on hits by the Beach Boys. I Get Around and Help Me Rhonda has Carl Wilson playing a 12. But by 1966, demand for Rick 12s was declining at Rose Morris in the UK, and by 67, they'd concentrated their orders on the 6-string models. In 66, they'd introduced a revised line of guitars with thinner full bodies, including, a little later, a 360-12F. These new models had the control layout in a curving line near the edge of the body that were no longer mounted on the pickguard. Though production increased at Rickenbacker, they couldn't keep up with the growing demand in the States, and it wasn't uncommon to wait 6 months for a guitar. The Jefferson Airplanes rhythm guitarist Paul Kantner began using a 360-12, using it to replace an acoustic 12 he'd used for strumming parts in the studio. A new higher output pickup, appropriately named the High Gain, was introduced in 69. That same year, they introduced 24 fret fingerboards on the 300 series guitars. And though they made both the 21 and 24 fret boards for a while, their 21s were phased out by the mid-1970s. A modernized 381 appeared as a 12-string version and was added to the line as well as a 381-12. Around 1970, the deluxe triangle fingerboard inlays were made slightly thinner. Dick Burke remembered that they did this to help leave more wood on the fingerboard, hence strengthening the neck, particularly on the 12 strings. Also in the early 70s, they launched their first new body shape in many years, the solid body 430. They also brought the body style from their basses and built the 480 six-string guitars. The original bass design had come out in 1957, and in 1983, they issued a 12-string version in the 340. Of course, when the Beatles split in 1970, it probably contributed to Rickenbacker's decline. Their guitars were used much less often, but their basses saw a boost in popularity from Chris Squire from Yes using them, and production shifted more towards basses, which continues to have some popularity to this day with players like Charles Michael Parks Jr. of All Them Witches. He uses a very interesting 4001. After this boost in the mid-70s, demand for Ricks again fell off. In 1983, they made an attempt to recreate some of their classic models, trying to get on the vintage instrument bandwagon that was growing at the time. Unfortunately, like the late 60s Les Pauls, the reissues weren't very accurate. Another moment in the sun came when XTC's English Settlement album was released in 1982. Dave Gregory has recently got a 12-string Rick and delighted in using the 1976 360-12. The sound of the guitar inspired Gregory and the rest of the band to look to the great sounds of the 60s groups like the Byrds, pushing the band in a new direction compared to their previous album. Around the same time, the band The Church was making good use of a Rick 12-string. Their biggest hit, Under the Milky Way Tonight, in 1988, saw Marty Wilson Piper using his electric 12 as an arpeggio machine, adding wonderful counter melodies. His favorite Rick was a Roger McGuinn model 370-12. And then came along Peter Buck and REM. Buck bought his first Rick in 1980, a Maple Glow 6-string, but that guitar was stolen about a year later, and he then bought his famous, beloved 360 6-string. Of that guitar, Buck said, "I've played that guitar on stage and in the studio my entire adult life." His particular 360 has an unlacquered ebony fingerboard, and he's added a brass bridge. He strings it with a 13 to 58 set of strings. Buck was drawn to Ricks because of Harrison, Townsend, and McGuinn. Early on in the band history, he couldn't afford or find a Rick 12, but by the mid-80s, he could and found one using it on many of the band's hits. He's been seen with the McGuinn model and the Tom Petty signature model as well. As much as he liked the sound, he says you have to be careful to use a 12-string sparingly, as they take up so much room in the mix. And echoing Dave Gregory, he says that you have to tune your G string slightly flat, so that when you start fretting it up the neck, it pulls into tune. F.C. Hall's son John had worked at the company for many years, and he took over in 1984. They reformed the company as Rickenbacker International Corp., or Rick. He began changing the models, and sales and marketing offices were opened in England and Japan, and launched a series of vintage reissues program that came out that very year. He was able to do this well because, unlike a lot of other guitar companies, Rickenbacker had held on to many of the original guitars over the years, so they could refer to their own collection along with photos and other company records. Starting as an idea to do limited run, it was expanded to instead to offer signature models. Certainly not a new idea in the guitar manufacturing business, but it was new at Rick. They decided to stir together the two ideas and do limited runs of signature models, issuing numbered certificates with each guitar, often in runs of just 1,000. Rickenbacker has done limited edition signature guitars with Pete Townsend, Roger McGuinn, John Kay from Steppenwolf, Susanna Hoffs from the Bengals, John Lennon, Tom Petty, Glenn Frey, Carl Wilson from the Beach Boys, Chris Squire of Yes, and Lemmy Kilminster of Motorhead. A full outline of all of the limited edition models would fill another video on its own, but since I was so deeply influenced by the Damn the Torpedoes record in my youth, I'll share that story here. The Tom Petty signature limited edition guitar was based on a guitar that Tom didn't even own. The guitar on the cover of Damn the Torpedoes is owned by Heartbreakers guitarist Mike Campbell, a 620/12. But because the album was so huge, Petty became associated with that guitar. When approached by Rick about the signature model, Petty asked that the neck be slightly wider, 1¾ inches, at the nut. He also spec'd bird's-eyed maple and checkered binding along with the original fire glow finish. The story of Campbell's 620/12 is well known. Having found an ad in the local music paper, The Recycler, for a Rick 12, Campbell headed out to Anaheim, hoping for a classic 330, only to find the solid body 620. Though he wanted the one like George Harrison had, he bought the guitar anyway because he'd made the long drive. It was just before their second album, and he'd gone looking for a Rick 12 because they were looking for the sound of the Byrds on a couple of the songs. Years later, when he took the guitar to the Rick factory, they looked at the serial number and informed him that it was the guitar made immediately after the one they'd made for George Harrison. Not only was it one of the first Rick 12s ever built, but it gave Campbell a bit of Beatles connection he'd hoped for. I've partnered with Truefire because I've used them for over a decade, and my playing always improves when I put in the time on their lessons. Whether you're a beginner, intermediate, or professional level player, Truefire has lessons to inspire and advance your playing. As you know, I always recommend spending money on lessons before new gear, and I think if you give Truefire a shot, you'll like them too. Get 25% off courses using the promo code 5Watt25, or like I have for many years, sign up for the All Access Pass to use the entire Truefire catalog. You can sample anything in the catalog with the All Access Pass, and you can see where the muse takes you. I love their tagline, learn, practice, and play with Truefire. I'd like to thank Truefire for partnering with me and sponsoring this video. The Smiths' Johnny Marr used a 12-string prominently on Stop Me, if you've heard this one before, from 1987, where his Rick 12 was the foundation on which the entire tune is built. As an interesting aside, the first time you may see Marr playing a Rick 12 on the band's appearance on Top of the Pots playing This Charming Man, the guitar was actually one he borrowed from Roxy Music guitarist Phil Manzanera. This made people think that it was a 12-string on the record, though the Top of the Pops performances are famously lip-synced, and you can see that none of the guitars are even plugged in. In 1989, the company brought its manufacturing offices back into the same building on the corner of South Main and Stevens Streets in Santa Ana, California, where it remains to this day. This led to many improvements in manufacturing, and they upgraded the facility. By the mid-90s, following along with another surge in sales, the factory had grown back to near mid-60s levels, with between 60 and 85 staff over the next decade. Going into the 90s, you could hear Rick 12s on the U2 single Even Better Than the Real Thing, from their Octum Baby record, The Edge playing a whammy pedal on his 330-12. In 1995, Mary Chapin Carpenter had a long string of hits featuring the sound of her Rick 12, most notably, probably, He Thinks He'll Keep Her, with its chiming intro. And who can forget the Rembrandts 450-12 on I'll Be There For You, that was used as the theme song for the TV show Friends, bringing the sound of her Rick 12 into the homes of millions of viewers each week for a decade, and the late-night grocery store aisles to this day. When asked why Rickenbacker hasn't offered any new models in decades, John Hall generally points to the fact that they have such a backlog of orders for their traditional models that they've never really felt that they had production capacity to build something new. All great guitar companies should have such problems. If I missed your favorite part of the Rickenbacker 12 story, put it in the comments for everyone to enjoy. I know from experience that I can count on you. First, I need to thank the extraordinary Jason Loughlin. My moderator, Phil Mingan, thought to check with Jason, and lo and behold, Jason had a 64 330-12 ready to go. The recording shows why you should all be watching Jason's YouTube channel and checking out his lessons on Truefire. Two techs were instrumental in pulling together my research. Tony Bacon's The Rickenbacker 12 and Richard Smith's Rickenbacker, A Complete and Illustrated History. Both books are listed in the description. I need to thank Perry McManus for wading through another of my scripts. Perry and I would like to encourage everyone, as we safely begin to reopen, that many musicians have gone without their primary source of income for over a year. So if you can afford it, consider buying a t-shirt, physical media, or other merch from those favorite musicians. And in particular, I need to thank the Friends of 5Watt. It's an ever-growing group of guitar obsessives, and I appreciate you guys being along for the ride and supporting 5Watt World. If you enjoyed the short history of the Rickenbacker 12, hit the like button, and if you haven't subscribed yet, go ahead and hit that too. Thanks for watching. Until next time, thanks for being a part of the 5Watt World.